Holy Gospel for this morning is from Matthew chapter 22. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated, and we will sing now our sermon hymn, "It Is Well With My Soul."
Thank you.
Dear hearers of the Word of God, grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and from our Lord and our living Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our gospel reading this morning occurs in all three synoptic gospels. The word synoptic means to see with, to see alongside, to look at the same thing. So Matthew, Mark, and Luke all have this story, this exchange between the disciples of the Pharisees and the Herodians. They fought like cats and dogs. The Pharisees were a separatist movement, withdrawn from Roman society to exclusively practice the Jewish expression of faith. They did not agree with this taxing. They didn't want the people to do that. And yet here they are together with the Herodians. The Herodians, they held political power. They were aligned with Herod. That's why they called them the Herodians. They were a political party that supported the kings in power. They encouraged submitting to them and the followers so that they could gain political expediency. The support of Herod compromised Jewish independence in the minds of the Pharisees. So they were at exact polar opposites in terms of the place of political power in the life of the faith in the people of Israel. But one thing united them. They argued about everything else, but one thing united them: opposing Jesus. And on that, they were agreed. Herod himself wanted Jesus dead, and the Pharisees had already planned a plot against him after they found out that he had raised Lazarus from the dead. Remember, this is in the Gospel of Matthew now. This is Holy Week time. This is after he turned over the money changers' temples and he rode the donkey on Palm Sunday. This is after that. And they're kind of running out of time here. We have to do something to catch him. And so they hatched this plot. In their minds, it's a lose-lose proposition for Jesus. No matter how he answers this question, he's going to lose. And so their trap is baited and set. Okay? Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. You show deference to no one. You do not regard people with partiality. Or the literal phrasing is, you do not see the face of anyone. You do not look at the face of anyone. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? And here, that's the trap, okay? Now, the tax in question refers to a Roman tax upon personal property and harvest. And it was regulated through a census and registration. We all know how Jesus came to be born in Bethlehem, because Joseph had to be registered to find out who's in this country. That's what the emperor wanted to know. Who are all these people? Want to keep tabs on everyone, find out who's who and where they live. Well, the religious leaders, the people invested in the temple and the surrounding, have political power, and they helped collect the tax. Although many Pharisees didn't think it should be done at all, they still helped it. Resentment of Roman taxation had sparked pockets of revolts around Judea and Galilee. Jesus, when he was a youngster, probably when he was 7 or 8 years old, witnessed the crucifixion of 5,000 Galileans who tried to revolt and create an uprising against the Roman government. And that's how Rome dealt with it, very swift and very brutal. And so he understood that. And he saw it for himself. And so there's always this resentment that these Romans are everywhere, we've got to get rid of them. And yet other people said, we have to just be careful, because if we're not, they're going to kill us all. The question of taxation between Rome and the people is common to us today, right? It's still a rather heated topic, one in which can easily sway the crowds, either for Jesus or against. They can turn to Jesus and say, yes, we want to follow him. He says, we shouldn't pay taxes. But then that would get Jesus on the bad side of the authorities. The question then, is it lawful to pay taxes? Is the equivalent of asking a politician, have you stopped beating your wife yet? How do you answer that without getting caught? And that's what they're trying to catch Jesus on, the tax issue. What are you going to do? Either way, we caught. Interestingly enough, Jesus knows what they're asking about. He knows which coin. So he asked them, show me the money. Or what's in your wallet? Or one of them, what does he say? No, show me the coin. That's what he says. And they reach out and show him a denarius minted with the image, the icon, the image of Tiberius Caesar. This is from an old money magazine that's showing. There's a really long word name for people who collect coins. Bruce Atwater knows the name. I can't even pronounce it, but it's whatever. It's a long name, but it's people who collect coins. And they say this, or this is what it is. Show me the coin. Whose head is this? Well, our coins have images on them. We all do. We all see them. Most of my coins have Lincoln on them. This is what it says. It's printed like the first letters. Tiberius Caesar, Divi August Filius Augustus. Filius means son. Okay, Filius. Son of the divine Augustus. Or the way it's printed, the way it's minted on the coin is divine is the first word. Tiberius Caesar is divine. He's the son of the divine Augustus, which makes him divine. God. And on the back side, on the other side, it shows him sitting on a chair, and it says Pontiff Maxim, the greatest priest. Okay. So when he says, show me the coin whose image, it's a theological statement that the Romans make. They say, well, whose head is it? It's Caesar's, the emperor's. But they do not quote the title. Because if they did, they would be saying, Caesar, Tiberius Caesar, is a son of God. They don't go there. Already, you can almost see they're turning white, wondering what's going on. In one quick move, he removes the bait, and the trap is broken. Give, therefore, to Caesar, to the emperors, the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. The verb translated as give, and give to Caesar, literally means to give back. Give back the things that are Caesar's. And give back the things that are God's. It's the same verb used a couple weeks ago when we had the parable of the tenants. The man built a vineyard and he leased it out to people and he was going to collect the produce. And Jesus warns that the owner of the vineyard will lease, the Pharisees say, they're going to kick those tenants out, they're destroying them, and give it back to someone else who will return the produce rightfully. The verb used here, give back to God what is rightfully God's. He doesn't quite answer it, yes, it's lawful or no, it's lawful. But he does indirectly say, yeah. If you owe taxes, you got to pay it. St. Paul does the same thing in Romans. You pay taxes to whom taxes are due, honor to whom honor is due. Live peaceably with one another if you can, as best you can. But then it goes beyond what is owed to the emperor, what the Caesar had. What is rightfully the emperor's? What is rightfully God's? Perhaps the question for us is, whose image, icon, that's a Greek word to use, icon. We all know what that is now if you work with computers, right? Whose icon do we bear? Yesterday, we had a wedding here. Sally Kibiski and Robert Kolstad, or David Kolstad. And I talked about the beginning of what marriage is about how God said that man, it's not good that man is alone, and he'll make a partner fit for him, creates woman for man. Well, before that story, the Bible tells us about how God created us in his image. Now, if you've ever worked with clay, like this person here, you know that your fingerprints get put in it. When you mold it, if you work with clay or Play-Doh or silly putty or anything like that with your hands, your fingerprints get pushed in there. You can't help it. Whose image do we bear? In the image, and this is what Jesus asks, whose image is on the coin? The Pharisees said to him, you don't look at the face, the image of anyone. In other words, you don't look at the face and go, oh, I'm going to be treating better than the other because I recognize this person has power. So you don't look at the face of anyone. Whose image, whose face are we creating? In the beginning, the very beginning, it said, all of us, men and women, male and female, are created in the image of God. Male and female. From that standpoint, what doesn't belong to God? Now, Psalm 50. Here's Psalm 50. Every wild animal of the forest is mine, says God. The cattle on 1,000 hills. I know all the birds of the air and all that moves in the field is mine. One of my favorite psalms. Some of you know this. This is an older translation. This is the way I had it. That's the way I memorized in confirmation. The older wording. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The world and all those who dwell therein. If the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The world and all those that dwell in. If we are created by God's hand and we bear his image, if we are the Lord's, all creatures of our God and King, if we are not our own, but have been bought with the price of Jesus Christ, then who shall we fear? Of whom or of what then shall we be afraid? Our coins say, in God we trust. Do we? A coin can bear the image of an emperor, a bird, a loon, if you're from north, your northern neighbor, or a queen, or in our case, dead presidents. But the good news is we bear the image of the living God, who cares for us, who made us. We are ambassadors for him. We bear his name. We bear his word and his work throughout the world. Thanks be to God for that opportunity, for indeed that blessing and that reminder. Amen. Please stand. Let us confess.